Hey, dude,
show me.
Coming up,
I like in this.
Let me just write that down.
Where's this gonna go?
I'm about to tweet them.
So it's also busy streaming live, actually.
I don't know how good the stream is, but I recognize this oak.
Oh, cool.
Hey, how do I spell his name?
Pepper, P-E-P-P-E-R.
Oh, just as in Pepper Pepper.
Yeah.
Oh, lekker. Pepper. In fact, let's do it this way.
Just this past week, put up a website for my speaking.
Oh, really?
Activity, yeah. Articles.com. I'd love to put this up on that site.
Please do. Definitely do.
Can you email it to me?
Yes.
You got my email address?
I have. Will it get you via Twitter?
Not the best way.
Okay.
Unless you... Look, if you put it up on Twitter, it's going to be what's going to be used?
I'm glad you recognize that.
What?
So what's happening in the real world? Yeah, I'm sorry. You know, puns are unavoidable.
Can I make one suggestion?
Please do.
Just put something about abundance of innovation. Because that will then...
Link to abundance of attention. Yeah, okay. Let's do that.
I like the X-ray specs and the... It's a fairly elaborate set of tools here to produce this visualization.
Yeah.
And you kind of try out every new kind of thing that comes along for...
I wish. Like the new Microsoft Surface Studio.
Yeah, that sort of thing.
Good God.
Yeah, expensive.
Yeah, but regardless of expensive, it's just probably the most ultimate machine in the world.
Really?
Yeah. It's just
Microsoft
up there. Yeah.
Probably.
We have an abundance of innovation. Oh, okay. Maybe I should change it.
Because I'm just
saying
the artist
how to engage. No, what art? It's not art. This is communication, so if I get it wrong. And I will email you, definitely.
I'll definitely put it up. And you must tell me what credit you want.
You just got it.
No, I mean, tell me how you describe yourself.
Okay, hold on. I'll do that. Arthur, so nice
ready
to see you today.
Cool.
Not
good. Good to work with you, in effect.
Yes. Kind of virtually.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Perfect. Hello.
You too. Ciao.
It's got a number of white. to speak for me. This name is just one of the people. It's done good. Anybody want to add that? Just keep speaking for me. Okay? This name is one of the people. This name is one of the people. When you speak, God can be great in your life. Do you? Sorry, can you speak about keeping the meetings in prayer? Right, so you speak about our ideas, our activity, and integration.
Yeah, I see.
Correct. Yeah, that's great.
Sounds right.
Thank you. You comfortable with the task next? Okay. Thank you. meters.
Thank you.
Yebo.
Two things.
Yes.
The YouTube thing.
Yes.
We wanted to cut it.
Yes.
And make it talks that we can post as individual talks on. I mean, they won't go on TED.com, but they will go on our YouTube channel. Don't laugh at me. I don't know how to download stuff from YouTube.
Okay.
What do we do? So it's possible to download it. That's
yes.
Also, you can download it.
Absolutely. And it's at full quality.
Okay. Okay.
And if not, I think it's saving here.
So. Okay, so I'm still talking about the art fair. But it's there, I know it. It's
oh,
there
it?
On YouTube, but I always look at it. So during the December holidays, that's our pet project.
Your plan. Okay.
And for this one,
Tomorrow, before the panels and discussion starts, we will collate all the tweets and ideas, and then we'll talk about the panel discussion. Okay? And then the next session is the university. So here we'll have a documentary that we'll be watching about Singularity University. It's basically about technology, innovation, artificial intelligence. Singularity University is in partnership with NASA, Google, so they bring all these smart people as part of the university and they conceptualize and come up with solutions. So that will also form part of tomorrow's session. I think that's the first session, and then so tomorrow is the second session. So tomorrow, still another session, session 6 and 7. Welcome to session 3. In session 3, we'll take you through music, opera, we'll take you through technology and innovation, and banking, funding. We'll look at solution in crime, environment, crime, and funding. So these are some of the topics that we'll be doing in this session. Okay. Our next speaker is a technologist. His company develops technology solutions for other companies. So they incubate all the solutions for other companies. He is very passionate about technology and innovation, and he's a lecturer, he's an entrepreneur, he's a technologist. His name is Gideon Potgieter, and we welcome him.
A lot of negativity, I heard today speaking this morning about the revolution,
I'm a good friend of myself, lived with a friend of mine 14 years. I'm back before, very excited, happy to be back. I recognize everything that what you do, absolutely true. So let's look at South Africa. I want you to remember this number, 630. We are the 15th largest GDP, economy in the world based on GDP, which is amazing considering we are in the G20 countries. Not quite sure how we got that right, but anyhow. We are in the G20 countries, although our economy is number 30. So keep the number 30 into account, and I want to show you some good news to you. Our road network, 10 in the world. Our airports, 11 in the world. I was telling you, because I'm coming up, because I was abroad, I've traveled immensely to most parts of the world, so I've been to many airports. I must be honest, the most beautiful airport for me is the King Charles Airport in Germany. I've not seen, I think, perhaps maybe in Germany, I suppose, but that's about it. Renewable energy, we've moved up to 650. We are 11th in the world in terms of what's called country attractiveness index, as measured by Mr. Young. They look at foreign investment, FDI, foreign direct investment into countries, sovereign countries. We are the 11th most attractive country. We are ahead of countries like Australia, India, these kind of places. So, quite attractive. Railways, very impressive. Transit figures just came out this week. Impressive figures, I must say, Paris Central. They show they can do what they can do. Energy in total, I know how Paris Central has been flogged and flogged and flogged, but we should not forget, we are still 90% of the world. Quite impressive statistic. Mobile telecoms, you know the big barriers in this country. Started in South Africa and expanded the footprint into the rest of Africa. Specifically in the world 19th as a country. So again, remembering this number 30. So basically saying that we are punching above our weight. Okay, for those of you who haven't been there, well, please go. I'll generally say to people, once you've seen you there, you will come back again and again. I'm speaking about people who will never see. Extras for sure, but definitely this is just true. World Economic Forum, you've seen this, the number of World Economic Forum, you've heard the bad news this morning. Very low on education, especially front education. But I would like to show you where we are operating in the economic space and why this is important for us. Number one in the world. Number one. In terms of according to the reporting standards. How come we just went through all of it now? I can tell you, it's strenuous and it's good. I mean, there's a reason why we are number one. Another number one, protection of minority shareholders' interests. Okay. I understand, you know, from politics, this number might seem skewed. But in terms of actual equity in shareholders, we are number one. And I'm talking, we are comparing ourselves to places, companies in London, in the UK, in New York, Tokyo. We are number one. Financing through local equity markets. This might sound surprising to start one for years. Yet, if you look at going concerns, this is a number we can be proud of. Okay, so I'm just going to go one back on that point. So, I know many of you, especially those in the finance world, we have this big risk tomorrow, Moody's is releasing what our status will be. Whatever happens tomorrow, let me tell you what it is today. Today, our country's credit rating, our sovereign credit rating, compares to countries like Portugal and Spain. These are large economies. The European space, they, what Spain is like, the top five of Europe, which is massive economy. We're competing with countries like Spain and Portugal, just to put that in perspective. Okay, I would like to share with you some of you who haven't already saw this picture already. This is probably one of South Africa's most famous, I would guess, or most recognized inventions. I'm taking a glass from the box. These are old innovations, you know. Still existing, when you go to most offers in the world, you will come across these things. It's called the dollars, or dollar set in the euro. This is for protecting the breakwater and harbors. This is to keep the water up. This thing is perhaps less known. It is considered as one of South Africa's top 10 inventions, again from the past. But moving to the fast going into the future, just putting this in perspective, most unassisted vehicles today are using technology that comes from this so many years ago. CAT scan. I'm fortunate enough to say I've never had to experience this, and I'm hoping none of you have. But if you have ever come across this machine called CAT scan, so that's a good invention. This you must recognize. This must have been probably one of the most used, what I would call, analog robots. Right? So it's robotic, it does its thing. for people who have not seen your train today, it goes around the swimming pool and basically cleans it up. So that was one of the first commercially available robots decades ago. That's the cost. I was speaking this morning about some interesting innovations coming from Africa. I haven't mentioned them in detail. The rest of the world is adopting that now. But I'm focusing on South Africa today. So here's something more recent. You might ask, well, it looks like another machine, like a CAT scan, well, in fact, not a CAT scan, X-ray. And you might say, okay, well, what's special about X-ray? We don't know how to take that. This machine is quite unique in the sense that it's fast. If you're in an emergency room, in your situation, you want the scene to be fast. Instead of waiting hours, there are some numbers, 30 seconds, this thing will scan 30 seconds. This is also one of the very few scanners that can do a full body scan. So, leading emergency rooms in the world uses this technology. The factory is not very far from here, probably about 20 minutes drive from here. Here in Joburg, where it's being manufactured. Another one, current slash recent, it's just been launched, it's been in development for many years. This is a breakthrough new kind of airplane, specifically light aircraft. Reconnaissance can be used in many applications. What makes this particular airplane quite unique is the fact that its screen speed can go quite fast. I would say 5 days fast, but it can go quite fast if you need to. While it has fuel economy, so long endurance, can do long flights, or what commands you fly on this thing. So you choose between fuel economy or speed. But the point is it's unique. The Boeing has this thing called skunk works. Many American large companies have things called skunk works, which means they're thinking out there, like Google X, for instance. When Boeing skunk works come out, they have to come and visit, to come and view this working concept, they do also. They could not believe what had been achieved. And this is a product that they're taking to read, so that's what they're taking to market. Something very special about this is this notion of bots, and why I'm mentioning this is the aircraft manufacturer is not actually manufacturing bots. This will be manufactured by the large aerospace companies, the Boeing and Airbuses of the world. We'll be manufacturing bots for this aircraft because they see the future in this aircraft, what potential might. Now the most special one, this is not the premiere, and I'm going to stick with this one for premiere for a moment. I believe he's a case study, but in fact he should be standing here telling a new story. And I'm hoping you will at some point. Amazing person. He took this thing from idea, came to idea, was a dream actually when he was a kid. When he became an adult, he had the opportunity, so he went through all the hurdles in his life that he had to cross, went through the hurdles, finally got his dream into an idea, designed, when he approached us, it was prototype. When we had to go to manufacturing, this is where it got stuck. We could not reproduce the prototype, so we had to go back. But this is where he had the sense of approaching experts, professionals to help him to do this test. Basically, his product will save a lot of water in the world. One toilet system can waste up to 700 liters of water a day. 700 liters, just listen to that number. But his thing will stop that 700 liters of water. That's been tested, it's been put into community centers, well tested, well prepared, and I believe he's going to go global. I really believe this is one of our next major industries. Just some pictures. So we took it all the way through to production in the one city, Joburg. And this is just an example of how he's now started assembling. So this is the assembly facility where it's kind of strange in an office environment. It should be in a factory, but anyhow, we've got it, so you know, thanks for that. This is the final product. So this is the product that's being installed as we speak. So some of them being assembled in recent weeks, and they are going to the first 20 feet so that we go. If this particular case of municipality loves it, then we'll wrap it up. He sells like at each business model is going into hundreds of millions of rands. He's potential business system is one part of the business. So phenomenal guy. Just the last part of that. So basically the different components. So he had the idea, had the dream, and he's sort of all the way through. Now that's all pretty nice to say, well, excellent. So we have innovators, we have people that bring some very exciting projects to the market. But we have the history, we have the legacy of some very exciting technologies and products. But where do you from here? And I've heard some speakers speaking this morning about this notion of education. We heard the number this morning. We were very low number. I think 38, I can't remember the number, but it was like 120 something. Really bad. I can understand the positives, I don't even remember the positive numbers. But it was shocking. Okay, so how do we get there in the future? Sorry, just the last one on this robot. So this is, again, unique to Notion out of South Africa. This is a road forward that works with pipelines. I don't think they have other companies in Europe and have in the US. This thing is quite unique in the sense that it's a full virtual reality environment. You see a lot of innovations in South Africa, especially in the mining environment around simulation and simulators, where people are sitting in a room and simulating a sector under the mine. This takes it a step further. This is going into pipelines, and that's assuming you are crawling the pipe, following this thing. This particular team, very young, less than 3 years old, startup, NGO guys, or some roboticists and some NGO guys got into this business. They have been selected on the NASA program now to work on the robot. They're qualifying around now to work on the robot for NASA that we're working on. And the program is then based on the NASA platform. So just be nominal thing to guys to do NASA in just 2 years. This is an amazing number. This is something that's very close to my heart. I heard someone saying, why don't I do the slide? I'm very almost emotional. Million people. This company has assessed 1 million youth trying to position them somewhere in the job market. They have brought 1 million people into potentially 200,000 candidates, and this is over a period of about 4 years. I've traveled the world, I've not done a lot of research on this, but I have come across very few instances in the world where these kind of numbers are shown or have been achieved. So in the future, this is a place far, far away. For those of you outside the borders of South Africa, I just mentioned what to me is the most beautiful airport in the world, Kinshasa Airport in Durban. This is about over 2 hours drive from Kinshasa, so if you follow that map up, you know, that's Google Maps, then you get to the school, Lemme, really in the middle of nowhere. Okay, there's like a very nice nature park on one side, a very nice nature park on the other side, but right slap bang in the middle of this nature park is this very rural area. Now, in this rural area, they've started building these computer labs. I'm not suggesting that technology is the answer, the only answer, but I do believe technology is an answer. It's a, call it a bridge to get students exposed, scholars exposed to what's out there, what kind of technologies are there. And this is really where the nation's future is going. So technology in this case being applied, we are highly heavily involved in this particular computer lab sponsored by a European non-profit organization managed by the Department of Science and Technology. And in this particular instance, the Department of Science and Technology insisted that the technology used should be local. So basically the whole offering solution, solar panels for that organization. So this is a fully off-grid South African solution, computer lab where kids, you know, basically that technology get exposed to what's out there, and then there's a lot of course content out there, and get exposed to the modern world. Thank you.
Someone screamed and someone in the world. And neither people were in trouble. his phone, he called his cousin, police officer at the nearby police station. Fortunately, his cousin was on shift that night. Unfortunately, by the time the police arrived, the old man got away. Why did the police phone his cousin instead of calling 141 or 112? Why did it take the police so long to arrive? Who did you call to be the witness? The system used by the police currently is like that. It takes civilians too long to alert the police, and it takes officers too long to respond to crime. Accountability is low, customer service is poor. The way that the police respond to crime needs to change. Traditionally, if you call 141 or 112, you'll get a call. You'll hear something like, this call is important to us. Please call. South Africa has 11 official languages. What happens if you, the call taker, speak a different language? When the call taker finally answers, they will ask your name, surname, the nature of the crime, as well as the name of the nearest intersection to your right. We know the name of the nearest intersection to our right. What happens if you live in a township with no street signs, find yourself in a car, notice the distinguishing landmarks other than a large day? This is a long, drawn-out, historic process. Once the call taker has captured your details, they will pass it on to a radio operator. Each operator commands a radio network for large areas, sometimes more than these 10 police stations at once. You'll appear somewhere on the call field in the future. They will read the details and pass it on and over the radio network all for the vehicle assigned to deal with your kind of complaint. When an officer acknowledges, the radio operator will read the details of your links over the radio operator. This is a long, drawn-out, and slow process which has not changed much in the past half century. In the beginning of last year, the team and I were looking at Europe and discussing how the system would revolutionize the taxi industry could be used to help people get assistance faster. We started looking at how we would apply the series and realized that of course a meaningful impact on all flash cash, it needs to start with public flash cash. It needs to start with people. So we approached the city of finance and the finance agency to meet the partners and proposed that idea. Together we agreed to launch the pilot. So we hired a 21-year-old software developer, asked him to build a pilot application for us. We called it Nthabeleng. Based on the final word, Namola, means Italy. We provide the app, the final piece of one provider box, and Huawei is one of the smart. For fast needs, the citizens living in Monument Park outside Victoria have access to the world's first Uber for business. The community were able to download the app and with the push of a button share their location with the officer station in the community. We have some alerts. Most of the tests and minor attempts, but I guess that what happens is we had a lot of police officers in small neighborhoods. After the pilot, we reviewed the feedback, looked at the data, and decided that this actually was the potential to change the way we respond to crime. We went back to the city of Kwani, and together we agreed to move forward. Today, no more days left. Over 1,100 police officers have been trained how to use the system. Over 280 million police vehicles have been fitted with tablets. Live tracking has been installed in the control room, the war room, as well as offices of senior management. Today, this morning, if you want to skip time, you can take out your app, wait for it to get your GPS coordinates, and hit the press release button. It's all about these new notifications, the nearest three police officers will be taken to you. The first available officer access is directed to your location. As easy as that, it's as fast as that. The time from when all is activated to your cross connect is from minutes to seconds. What about false alarm? profile group you're responding access, we have the ability to message them as well as you control it. The officer has the ability to phone you if necessary. When the officer arrives, they have notified you and lets you know and asks you to identify yourself. Once the event is dealt with, the officer will rate the incident and the user will categorize it. This is customer feedback. Up until now, our focus has been on getting this class starting order, installing servers that train officers, ensuring that when someone activates that, they get the help that they need. We've learned a lot over the last few months. We've learned a lot about police processes, their shifts, their systems. We've also learned a few things about how smartphones don't handle the use of the dashboard very well. Tablets are much better suited. I also learned a lot about police officers and leaders. I've learned that for every good cause, there are 10,000 people. There are many people in support that are committed to the program to make an impact. One day, everyone has smartphones, and all smartphones will come with a panic button to install office. This will allow you to notify every police officer, police ambulance, and fire services to pick up. Instead of having multiple law enforcement agencies, our SAPS network links various traffic services, all doing similar tasks with very little coordination. Mobile technology will break down barriers in traffic. As the system gets more and more widely and more used, it will become a great source for reliable, high-quality, accurate crime and crime-fighting information. This will allow us to allocate resources more effectively and ensure that we respond appropriately. Without human intervention, the system will start automatically dispatching police vehicles, fire trucks, and ambulances to areas that are likely to take the event based on the system model. We will become smarter. Using away from software, all public buildings, schools, library clinics, banks, and ATMs display directly to software. So when an ATM or a bank is being robbed, when schools are facing crisis, ambulances and police officers will automatically dispatch to provide much needed assistance. Criminals will become deterred because at the speed and real cost of this force will be from Africa, will become safer. One day, families will be able to play outside knowing that if they need fast, reliable, accurate police support and help, they'll just need to say a few words. Hey Siri, call the police, and help will be on the way. Thank you.
I was hearing government talk about you need to be black, you need to be young, As a blind engineer, I said, come on, I'm deaf, tick. I'm young, tick. I'm a woman, tick. I'm beautiful and I'm hot. And I started doing research on what grief means to us as people being deaf. Because in South Africa, there's a stereotype about hearing and being deaf. You need to be this black man who is deaf, paid baby, and you need to wear certain type of shoes to show that you are a tender man. But hang on, there's more to this triple B yet. I found out that at the time there were certain elements to it. And the first one is ownership. And what meant is that white owned entities in South Africa were looking for black entrepreneurs or black business people for transformation to take place. And instead of me complaining that we're not getting opportunities, for me it was, wow, this is how we correct the things of the past. Because they're not just looking for me as a black young woman. They're looking for me as a black young woman with masters in entrepreneurship. They're looking for me as a black young woman who is qualified to be an accountant or a scientist or a business person. So they're looking for me for the brains that we have and the knowledge and the skills that we have. Not solely because of the gender and the color of skin. They're looking for more. And for me, that's why it's probably important. And for us, when we started the Young Women in Business Network, it meant that it's a stepping stone to get and participate in the economy of our country. But what it really meant is that it is time that Black South Africans start participating in the economy of South Africa. And not just imposing ourselves in white conditions that we know nothing about, that we just can create a money to understand the part of that company. But what it meant is that it gives us a stepping stone that prevents that creating our own legacy, that one day my great grandchildren will be able to say, this generation of black people, this is what they want. In 2014, our legacy is the concept of cognitive banking. Let me share that. In 2011, when I was doing research, I found out that stock stock makes what 4 billion in South Africa. This year, I'm not talking about 4 million, no, I'm not talking about 30 million. Billion or 40 billion. I'm talking about 40 billion that for years we've been told stuff not by e-commerce sector that is not recognized in this country. This is something that is left to be told that we can't say that we don't understand the culture of money, we can't respect money. But yet we are able to say, short and savings, that accumulates to 44 billion in the hand. Hear me out. We're not talking about plastic money. That's a credit card that when people call, we don't answer our calls because we now need to pay back. I'm talking about money that is disposable to have, the money that is sent hand to black people in the country. But yet, for us, this is not the stuff. For us, this is a way of life. This stuff was a social thing that people come at the end of the month and they save money. And then come the end of the year, between 15 December and 23rd of December, we spend 40 billion of that buying groceries. And this is something that we don't understand. Because for us, it's a way of life. For us, it's not business. For us, it's not us participating in the economy of our country. Remember I said you about that? That's what I thought. And we're watching a big truth to the concept of cooperative banking. And when I listen about cooperative banking, I understand that, come on, wait a minute. Cooperative banking is stuck for us. And the stuck for us is something that is now termed the Cooperative Banking Act. Because what it really means is that our financial sector, when I say ours, I say the South African financial sector is one of the best in the world. But the best South Africans are not participating in that. Yet in 2015, 2016, the stock market made 50 billion rand. This is the sector that is growing in skill, expense, informal sector. And when I listen, I say, but this is subtle. This is something that you understand. This is something that my great grandmother did. This is something that my grandmother did. This is something that my friends still do in today. And when we started doing research about what we can do to use the Cooperative Banking Act for us to participate in the banking sector. Because we believe that the current banks are not conducive to the black community. They are totally not. Our banks are not designed for integration. Our banks are not designed for entrepreneurship. Because entrepreneurship, or any entrepreneurship, is about purchase orders and tenders. And we find people running around with our purchase orders and tenders, not being able to do the job because they can't get money. It's not that they're incapable. It's because they don't have the money to do this. So when we decided that the young women in business network, that we are going to talk to our members, that we are going to save money every month because we've got structural gaps. But instead of us going to put a billion in a week to buy groceries, we're going to channel that money into enterprise funding. Because it is time that we're going to save the entrepreneurs. And really, we need to put our own money into ensuring that our own businesses succeed without expecting somebody else to do that. And when we started in 2014, with the requirement we need a minimum of 200 people, we need 100,000 members to take a vote. And we said that that's 500 members of Cowper. When are we going to get us funding 500,000 members? Of a million rands. So we are going to put out this 2 million rands. It means that those minimum 200 people are each going to pay 10,000 rands in the and to be able to raise over 2 million rands in less than 8 months, something that has never been done in the country. And over and above that, we save 1,000 rands every month for a period of 5 years, close to enterprise funding. And today, I'm happy to say that we have over, we started saving in March 2016, 1,000 rands. Now, we have over 380 people, and the collective have over 6 million rands. Half of that will already fund our enterprises, a minimum of 330, a maximum of 350,000 rands for their enterprises. Because what that means is, finally, we get to invest in our own businesses and take ourselves. And through that, it will then be an answer to job creation in our country. And it is through cooperation, not because of race or gender. It is time that we come together and start working together to create jobs in South Africa. And it is through that we believe as a collaboration. Us working together will be able to reduce the 7% unemployment rate in the country. We'll be able to reduce that 1,000 days of engineering skill for the continuing education. So as a young woman in business, when we think about banking, it starts with us saying we need to participate in the financial sector of our country. And secondly, it says it is this generation, us in the room that we're able to change that. Because it has been 2 years into the development. And it is us that have the economy that we now have. And if we go forward and we need to participate in special political events, we need to be able to take that into consideration. And then say, banking, it's a start. And when we start with banking, then we can move into insurance because we have the number of people and the financial backing of that. Then we'll be able to take back our country into our own hands. And we'll be able to take back what is due to us. And then we can invest in the insurance into education. Because then we'll have the pride and the business that we put into that. Into ensuring that South Africa becomes the world that we all want to be in. Not as an individual, but as a collective.
Thank you. very intimidating place to be in. Or even sharing fake chairs that also be very difficult for most people. The founder of Easy Equities, Charles Savage, wants all of South Africans to achieve financial dignity. And he's going to share with us how we hope to achieve that. Let's welcome Charles Savage to the stage.
I just love this quote, especially in South Africa today, but not just here in South Africa, but around the world. Because fundamentally, ownership changes everything. 20 years ago, I was building websites for companies that thought that they would disrupt the world of e-commerce and change their industries. And I came about the industry of stockbroking for the first time, and whilst I always wanted to own my own shares, I never crossed the buyer. And so I got the opportunity to build technology for an online stockbroker and found that it varied my interests and my work, and so it became a passionate endeavor for me. So I jumped ship, stopped selling websites, and decided to see if I could democratize share ownership in South Africa. Fast forward 13 years, I'm sitting on a beach in Mozambique, having somewhat of a midlife crisis, reviewing my career, its success, and its failures. And I'm contemplating what we've achieved as a stockbroker community, what I've achieved in my endeavors and my career. And I'm drawn to this slide, which shows that less people than you ever imagined really own shares. In South Africa, back in 2000, when I joined the industry, there were less than 0.5% of the country's population owned shares. In 2013, that number was still the same, slightly higher at 0.6%. But the problem, which I thought was a South African problem, wasn't just a South African problem. It doesn't matter where you look on the slide. The problem is persists. Less people own shares than I would like. And so I decided to make it my mission to democratize share ownership every year. And the good news about that is that it's a cause that has a purpose. Shares are the greatest asset in accumulating wealth. And so they are also the greatest solution to closing the divide between the haves and the have-nots. The problem I had is I've been spending 13 years transformed and had little success. The industry had spent 2 decades trying to solve the problem, with very little success. And so what was I going to do this time around that was different from the last time? And I started getting ahead. We needed to do things differently. We need to abandon the failed strategies, platforms, and projects that had brought us here. And the first rule of what we were going to do was that if it's been done before, don't do it. But that didn't solve the problem as to what we were going to do. And so I needed to find relevance, I needed to find context, I needed to find a purpose, parallels in industries that had disrupted their industries, and see if I could make them apply in our industry, stockbroking. My first and favorite company, and I think lots of CEOs down on stage today want to recognize Amazon. I remember Amazon personally. I remember the story after building a bookstore back in 96. And I remember clearly that Amazon had no differentiator over the big company, the big booksellers, Barnes & Noble. They all had the same books. They had the same products. The price difference was marginal, and in fact Amazon was disadvantaged because it had no distribution. But yet, today, my kids can spell Amazon, not Barnes & Noble. Amazon do that gave relevance to what I was trying to do. And I was encouraged by this. What about the process that people buy books? Think about it. You're standing in a social circle, you turn to your friend Steve, and you say, Steve, what are you reading? And Steve says, I'm reading Good to Great. And so you ask Steve a couple of questions about Good to Great, and you confirm that Good to Great might be a book that's worth reading. And so you leave your social engagement, and you enter a bookstore, online, physically, and you start to search for more reasons as to why good to great might be. Because you haven't really made the decision to buy good to great, because you and Steve aren't identical. There are a couple of movies that he referred to that you didn't enjoy. And so what Amazon worked out is that they put more reviews around books and that you could make more connections with that book, you might have a chance of buying it. And guess what? Amazon sells more books than anybody else does today. In addition to that, if Steve enjoyed that book, or if you enjoyed that book, they could sell you more books from people who also enjoyed that book. And so again, Amazon sold you just only one book, they sold you multiple books. But what resonated with me is, isn't that exactly how we make our first investment? Buy our first share, we invest in our first unit trust. We stand around the social circle, because I work in financial services, people think I know stuff about investment. And so they'll ask me, Charles, what's the one share you think I should own? My response is swift. It should be the purple. And I tell them stories about how we try to democratize share ownership and the culture of the organization and the good work that we're doing. And so that person, let's call her Lindsay, walks away from that engagement, says, purple group sounds like a country that I should buy. And then she phones her stockbroker on Monday, and she phones Brad, and she says to Brad, Brad, I'd like to buy purple group. Now Brad's intrigued because Lindsay hasn't phoned before. And so Brad says to her, why would you like to buy purple group? And she responds, she says, no, I was standing around the prior to the Charles and worked for the purple group, and he was telling me good things about it. So I'm going to buy purple group. And she can start to hear Steve laughing, because that's not how we buy shares. We buy shares based on fundamental analysis, based on PE ratios, and dividend yield, and earnings per share. Stuff that Lindsay doesn't understand. And so she started to feel intimidated about the fact that she wants to buy purple group. How stupid of me to think that I would like to buy purple group. But let's assume that Lindsay's much more resilient than the average Joe, and she gets beyond Steve's discerning attitude. And she says to Steve, it's my money, I can do what I like. And so Steve then asks her the next question. He says, Lindsay, what price would you like to pay? Now Lindsay's feeling really stupid. Because I didn't discuss the price with her. We didn't say it. It was a 60-cent stock. She doesn't know whether it was a 6-cent stock, a 60-cent stock, or a 600-grand stock. And so now she's feeling even more intimidated. And now she's starting to think she's come to the wrong place. How stupid was she to think that she could come buy shares. But let's assume again that Lindsay's much more resilient than us, and she marches on. And the final question that comes from Brad is, Brad turns to Lindsay and says, Lindsay, how much would you like to invest in purple group? And Lindsay's response is, you know, I was just talking to Charles Robert Bryan, I'd like to invest a couple of hundred grand. And that's when the phone gets put down. Because we don't sell shares to people who want to buy should have a couple of hundred grand. Because you can't make money, and we can't make money either. And so nobody buys shares, because that's the experience of buying shares. That was the experience of buying shares. So the first rule of it had to be like Amazon. You had to make people feel smart about the fact that you had found someone who had engaged with you to talk about shares. And we had to surround you with information that gave you confidence to go on and buy your share, and not intimidate you out. And so we brought Amazon into the process. Uber's my favorite company of the current times, and I'm sure that there are hundreds of CEOs who stand up and say they want to Uberize the industry. I think it was now in the industry. Why was it so relevant to me? Why did it resonate to me sitting on that beach in Mozambique in December 2013? I was considering a business model, and it struck me that Uber, for the first time, the first company ever, that recognized that a customer is more valuable than his customer. Consider that for a second. You, the individual, is more valuable to Uber than what you spend with them. I don't know how many organizations there are out there that do that, but I know none other than Uber. And the reason why that was so important to Uber is that they didn't have a lot of money to market their business. And so they wanted you, the customer, to be their biggest fan. They wanted you to have extraordinary service that when you got out of the van, the car, you raised about you. And so Uber doesn't advertise. I see one advert in Flight magazine, and I guess that makes sense. But nowhere else have I ever seen them advertise. And they were so serious about it that they hid the transaction value away from the driver. Think about your journey. The car arrives promptly, the driver opens the door, he's dressed professionally, his car is clean, he offers you some water in the street, and the service is extraordinary. And then he finds out how much you were, how fast you were going. It's too late for him to discriminate against you. He delivered the service already. And the takeaway point is Uber doesn't discriminate. And as a financial services person who suddenly wrote an issue for 20 years now, that's struck a chord. Because in my view, financial services was the biggest discriminator in the world. Let me give you a scenario of prior to launching Easy Equities. Two customers walk through my door. The first one arrives with 100 Rand and the other one arrives with 1 million Rand. The 1 million Rand customer gets surrounded by agents, products and services, whiskey and cigars. He gets to stay as late as he wants and he gets what he needs. The 100 Rand customer sits in the foyer and works out for himself that there are no products and services he can get and pays for the parking on the way back. And so our challenge was, we needed to Uber. We needed to ensure that the 100 Rand customer felt as welcome and as many products and services as the 1 million Rand customer. And that created an extraordinary challenge for us, but one that we felt we had to overcome if we're going to live by our new rules. Finally, we had to be socially relevant. We had to ensure that investing in shares became something that we were prepared to put in Facebook and Twitter. Why? Because the way I've learned that is, if you like me, I don't wait for 35 days of instructions to play an offer. I stand by other players, I watch their moves and I learn the game, and that's how I've learned all complex games in my life. Chess, draughts, poker, blackjack, you name it. I've stood behind other players. And if we're going to learn this game of investing, then we need the people to allow other people to stand behind them. And social media provides that blackjack. And so those became our key rules. But you can't do it alone. And in order to truly democratize share ownership, I needed a team, I needed to empower them, and to do the things that I do. And so I had to put purpose over profit, because you do not get out of bed to make money for shareholders. You get out of bed to make a difference for people. And so we put purpose over profit. The second thing we needed to do is I needed to create an environment that was brave enough to fail in order to succeed. In my history, 9 times out of 10, the ideas that I come up with are terrible. They're useless. They fail. And sometimes it takes 20 ideas to get the first one that works. If you do not create a culture that embraces that, that gives a platform for people to fail, you will never succeed. And finally, we have to put culture over strategy. It is so much more important that your staff are happy and rewarded and engaged than what the word the CEO puts in a business plan. So those became our rules. What did we do? What did we create to make a little taste of what we've done? The old world was stockbroking, put minimums in front of us. When you add up all of the minimums, what you do is exclude 99% of the population. So what we did is we abandoned minimums, and so anyone can play the 65 cents per $100 investment. And we thought what we created was for the shopping market, where we were inviting everyone in to come and buy the shares that they love. And we realized very soon that what we were doing was creating this beautiful shopping market, low cover charge, but the rich shopping aisle 1 to 100, and the poor shopping aisle 95 to 100. And so we had to address share price affordability. And what we did is fractionalize shares so that everyone could buy the shares that they love, they want to own. And you can buy 1/10,000th of a share. Your $100 can buy you $1 of 100 companies, $10 of 10 companies. Finally, what we're trying to do, we had to change the engagement. We had to move away from a world of stock prices and graphs and red and green, because that's not what people understand. But they understand these brands. And so the engagement point is brands, not share prices. We had to change the methodology from how many shares you'd like to buy to how much you want to invest, because that's language that is familiar to you. And we had to take one investment and turn it into an investment pattern by ensuring at the purchase point that if you wanted to do it repeatedly, you could, every month, every quarter, every year. We had to ensure that it was transparent and affordable so that you trusted us with your money. And in addition to that, we had to behave like Amazon. And so people who buy Starbucks also buy Apple, American Express and Netflix. And guess what? You buy one share, you end up buying more shares. And finally, we had to address the biggest problem, because 80% of the world doesn't live in a place where they can have discussions and social meetings about shares. And so we brought asset managers to the platform so that people could buy baskets and bundles of the shares that they bought. But is it working? Just since 2 years, that platform launched 2 years ago. Just since we've launched, we've increased retail participation by 50% in a very short period of time. We saved South African investors $3.8 million. If you compound that out over 30, 40 years of investment life, that's the difference between retirement poor and wealthy. But this is the stuff that gets me out of bed and my team out of bed in the morning early. I've got stories from 92-year-old South Africans that felt that they were too stupid and too poor to ever own shares that were investing through the bank. I've got a 7-year-old daughter who runs around my house filling her easy equities money box with everybody's money. And then she pitches up at work and hands it to the brand manager who she trusts and says, please invest with all. My 18-year-old son, who matriculated today, has saved enough money since the age of 12 that by the age of 21, he will never have another cent towards his long-term retirement, just by swapping iPhones for investments. There is a group of kids who live in Soweto that are 18 years old that are building their wealth fractional share by fractional share every day. They're reading old newspapers and building an investment culture in a place that nobody expected. Our median age is 32. That's 2.5 decades younger than our competitors. And so we're addressing the millennial opportunity. We're getting the youth to invest. And fundamentally, this business is about getting 12-year-olds to invest. Because Warren Buffett said that the greatest investment mistake that he ever made, and he is the man when it comes to investments, was that he didn't start young enough. He was 11. 95% of our customers are first-time investors. So I'll ask you a question. Is it worth it? We think so.
guys are going to be sitting in the room to deliver some learners. What is your
name? Chocolate paste. I'll bring a visit to our garden for just the Abbey making paste.
Send me a tweet. I've tweeted all of them. Well, I am tweeting them. Oh, okay.
Instagram and Facebook.
So I'm also on Facebook. Roy Blumenthal on Facebook. So my name is there.
Okay.
Roy
Blumenthal on Facebook.
Yes.
Perfect. Thank you so much.
Cheers. Yes, I am. Are you as well?
Awesome.
I won the first prize. Imagine that.
A little girl from Elliot did it. As I continue my journey, I embrace not only my fears, but also my vulnerability. I truly believe that as I speak to you today, I have found my voice. I sing not with fear, but I sing with so much hope. I realize that when you are living on a purpose, your human experience that might seem small becomes grand and limitless. Art saves lives. It is that simple. I believe that if you give people the opportunity to practice and appreciate art, art of any form, their lives will be transformed. They will learn to value their own unique voices and visions. They will live their purpose. On that note, I wish to welcome my colleague JP, who is my pianist. I'll be performing an aria. I'll be performing my winning aria. It's titled "An Incredere Meraviti" from an opera La Sonnambula by Bellini. Thank you. I hope you enjoy it.
Thank you.
feedback at 4 o'clock for our last session of the day. Again, if you want to put yourself for a get to ride outside, thank you very much.
What? Yeah, it's cool. Thank you.
Abundance.
Thank you. So, Johnny Miller. Johnny came from Seattle in the US and has since made Cape Town his new home. But he's also a keen observer of society and people. And he's taken full advantage of his outsider's perspective to show us something that we've always known about ourselves, but perhaps we haven't quite seen the same way that he has seen it. Ladies and gentlemen, Johnny Miller is on the TEDx Johannesburg stage. Johnny.
I want you all to imagine something with me for a minute. Imagine standing somewhere far away from yourself, outside your own body, looking back at yourself. Imagine you're on top of a mountain. Imagine you're looking at the sunset. You're a small little silhouette. You can't see what color clothes you have on. You can't even see your face. Would it make you feel small and insignificant? Or would it make you feel more connected to everything around you? I actually had this opportunity earlier this year. I had my new toy with me. I just bought a drone. And I took it up to the top of Table Mountain, because I live in Cape Town now. And I shot this video, but this is still fun. Put it together, it was an awesome video. Everyone really liked it. I edited the video together, I put it on the internet, and my friend watched it. And my friend watched it and he said to me, wrote me an email, he said, I've never seen Table Mountain look like it looks in this video. And that might seem like kind of a throwaway comment, but to me it was really, really profound. I thought, this is the most iconic landmark in South Africa. It's definitely the most iconic landmark in Cape Town. And this new perspective, this, what I call a toy, is actually an extremely powerful piece of technology. It totally changed how he saw Table Mountain. And I started to think, well, what else could I apply this really strong perspective shift to? This is important to me because I'm a photographer. And I always thought that if I wanted to tell someone's story, the best way to do that was to look into their eyes. It was to take photos, show people's faces, and try to create a sense of empathy by looking into someone's eyes. But I realized that maybe I need to start thinking outside the box. I live in a city where there's tons of barriers everywhere. I live in a city where there's fences, where there's walls, where there's highways, and specifically what interested me, as you can see in this photo, there's big open green areas where people have designed the city to be separate from one another. It's very difficult to see over these fences, especially if you're living in an area like this that's flat, because we live at ground level. We don't get to see this perspective very often. We surround ourselves with people that look like us. We surround ourselves with communities that seem like we should be a part of it. We drive the same cars as our friends. We have the same jobs as our friends. Our kids go to the same schools as our friends' kids go to their schools. But right next door to us, there's a community of people who live in red-colored houses. And those people in the red-colored houses, they have better cars. And they have better schools, and they have parks in their neighborhood. And oh, by the way, the houses are colored red. And that two-lane road that acts as a barrier to us physically, it also acts as a barrier to us mentally. It acts as a barrier to our imagination. We do this for a variety of reasons, I think. We tell ourselves that it's natural to bond together, to band together, to tribes. We tell ourselves that it's necessary for defense, that we're defending against an enemy, that we're protecting our families. There's a whole bunch of reasons that we try to use to justify why we like to live with other people who look like us. But my question was always, who are we defending against, and who are these enemies? When I went to University of Cape Town, I was really interested in these topics, like I said. And I found this map right before I did this project. I was thinking about it, it was inside my head. This is a map based on census data. And this is particularly Cape Town, but there's maps for all major urban metros in South Africa. And it really struck me. This is another way to look at the topic I'm talking about tonight with data, it really struck me how, by and large, people still live in those same areas that they were placed decades ago. And they're bounded by this infrastructure. You can see on this map behind me, you can see that blue square right in the middle is surrounded by roads, an industrial area, a power plant, and a big green belt. It's incredible how people can't seem to get out of these environments that we place them into. And that's important because the next slide that I'm going to show you is income level, also based on census data from 2011. And there's a very close correlation between people's income level and where they've been placed throughout the last 5-6 decades, at least in the city of Cape Town. So, after seeing that video and after having my friend comment on it, after having all these things percolate around my head, I decided to take this toy drone and take it down to an area near Cape Town where I live, an area called Norfolk. And I'd often pass by there and I thought it was interesting because there's a sort of very low income township area of Moscow, Malaya, right in the middle of relatively affluent housing estates. And I thought this would be a really interesting perspective shift to go down there and actually see what this looked like from the drone. And actually, this is the cul-de-sac that I flew from. I found this image on Google Street View yesterday. The housing estates in this area are atypical of South Africa. They're walled in with 2-meter-high fences. It's very difficult to see on the other side of those fences. It's also a flat area, so it's really difficult to see very far or to get a perspective to see what's very far away from you because everything's flat. So I decided to try it out. I hooked up my phone to my remote controller. I put the drone in the middle of that cul-de-sac, and I took off. And this is the video that I saw when I took off.
Realized right away that this was a much bigger project than just Cape Town, than just local.
and I wanted to get the rest of South Africa. So I very quickly, within the next couple of weeks, bought myself a ticket to come to Durban, and I took a road trip throughout the big metro areas in this area of the country. So I went from Durban to Midrand to the Gauteng area. And the last photo I took, which is the top left photo in this image, that was just a few kilometers from where we're sitting right now. The research that I put into all of these, like I said, I used the maps earlier. I also researched on Google Earth what the actual terrain looked like. And then I finally broke around and actually went to these areas because I had to fly at these areas. So in my research, I'm pretty confident that I found the most unequal areas in South Africa. But I didn't want to just focus on wealthy versus poor. I wanted to make the project broad enough to incorporate sort of my artistic vision, to incorporate visual metaphors, and other types of imagery that would inspire people to want to look above fences and to want to look at the other side, what was going on in their neighbors' yards, what was going on over the fences that they couldn't see over. So I incorporated it to have images like this, which is in Palma Center, right next to a cemetery in Tembisa, also not too far from here. A lot of people ask me, and I think probably some people still think, well, what's in it for me? Why does this matter to me? I don't live in those places. I don't really care about those things. What's the big deal? And my answer would just be, you're wrong. It does matter to you, and you should care about it. This little girl's name is Sita Sita. I met her about 2 months ago in a continuation of this project working with Thompson Reuters. She lives in Mombasa Park, which is in Kailicha, in Cape Town. She's 12 years old. She lives in a tin shack. But she's your neighbor. She goes to a South African public school. She's going to grow up, and she's going to have kids, and she's going to work. And she's going to become your neighbor, your co-worker, the compatriot that you live with in your city. She's a South African. And this is her neighborhood. This is Mombasa Park. Just as an example of the power of shifting your perspective, going from that view that we just saw a slide before to where she lives now and how effective it is at getting across certain points, I want you guys to spend the next minute and try to find where the toilets are in this photo. Anyone see the toilets? There's not very many of them, I can tell you that. There's 25,000 people that live in Ronald Beeson Park. You can see right here along this road, right in the middle of that road, there's a small little block of 10 toilets. And the day that I was there, 8 of them were locked, and 2 of them were broken. Those are the only toilets in this entire photograph. Everyone in this photograph has to use those 10 toilets if they want to go to the bathroom. If they don't want to use those toilets, they have to use the bush. And the bush is filled with dangers, like Sita's friend, who 5 years ago went to the bush to go to the bathroom, and never came back. These sorts of issues, these sorts of problems that your neighbors are dealing with, that's exactly why I wanted to start this project, and that's what I'm hoping that I'm starting to get across when people want to use aerial imagery in their storytelling, in their journalism, in their policy making. People ask me, what's my plan with the project? And I really, really hope that people are using my images, and I know they are, to plan conferences, to communicate ideas, to work on planning out how to better deliver services, how to better construct houses, how to make us all more equal. But really deep down, what I really want out of the project is to change people's mindsets, is to get people to tap into that compassion that I know we all have, that we feel for our neighbors, that neighborly love, that want to better our neighbors who live on the other side of the fences. And to do that, we need to understand what it is they're living in and what it is they're living like. Defining the problem is the first step towards solving it. So, as I finish up here, I really invite all of you guys, after you listen to me, when you go home tonight, when you go to your big houses, behind the fences, imagine what it felt like to be on this mountain and to float away from yourself and look back in. And try to do that in your own community. Try to float above your own house and try to see yourself as part of a holistic whole in your own city. If you can visualize that, then I think our neighbors are going to thank you very much, and we're going to move very quickly towards solving these problems that affect our cities. Thanks very much.
Thank you, John. Stephanie Cowper is our next speaker. She, again, is one of those who have known Stephanie for only a short while, maybe a couple of weeks, a month, but maybe 2 months. And in that short time, it's become quite clear that she has a big heart and an incredible capacity for empathy. And well, she's going to give us a little talk to Stephanie. Welcome to the TEDx Rising stage.
Today I'm here to open your eyes. I'd like to take you on a journey with a friend of mine, Rivett, a young man who's blind, as he makes his way to an interview for his dream job. Rivett wakes up at 5 a.m. to eat breakfast and get ready. His wife has taken the time to lay out his clothes for him. After getting ready, he steps out of the house, kisses his wife goodbye, and unfolds his cane. He makes his way down the cluttered street, tapping his cane as he goes along, dodging people, trash cans, advertising boards, each one making sure he can get around it. He then moves on until he gets to a busy street that he now needs to pass. He feels the traffic light, but there's no button. He can hear the busy cars whizzing past him, and he's hesitant to cross. Suddenly, a group of brave students make a mad dash across the street. But again, Victor's hesitant. He waits and waits until he can slowly hear the screeching of the brakes of the cars, and they come to a stop. He nervously tips his cane onto the tar and steps off the sidewalk and crosses the road, hoping no cars will jump the red light. Once on the other side, he arrives at the train station where he swipes his card, pulls down the escalator, and tries to orientate himself among the dreams past, but he can't find the edge of the platform. He's missed his first train. When the second train arrives, Victor boards and looks for the designated handicap seat. But there isn't one. Finally, when the train gets to his destination, he gets off and makes his way to the surface where he's standing outside the building of his job interview. He knows he's late. He taps his cane as he walks in and is directed to the elevator, where he feels the buttons and presses the number 6. Now there's no one inside the elevator with him. Tell him if it starts on the right foot. He waits nervously and realizes that he's just about to go. He walks outside the elevator, tapping his cane, this time along the skirting board, counting or looking for a fake, meaning there's a door. He lifts up his hand to feel for a clock, looking for a number of the room. It's 3. He's late and nervous, and he continues to go, tapping his cane, counting each day, until he gets to the room he assumes is the room that is usually taking place. He waits. Finally, a pair of footsteps come down the passage, and the person greets him, annoying him. Victor is late, and the interviews have gone on without him. Before I continue, I'd like to introduce myself. My name is Stephanie Cowper, and I'm a disability analyst. I've always had a passion for helping the community and technology, and in the last 2 years I've managed to bring those two together. I had a eureka moment and the heavens began to sing when I realised that I could use technology for the good of humanity. I was 22 years old and blissfully naive. I mean, why couldn't I change the world? I was in my final year of university and I was fortunate to spend 3 months studying at a world-class university in California. My major was technology entrepreneurship, and I found myself in the heartbeat of Silicon Valley. The point of technology entrepreneurship was to teach us how to form a tech startup, and I knew I wanted to help people. I formed a group, and one person in particular stood out, a tall electrical engineering master's student from Italy, Jacqueline. The question remains, who are we going to help? It was quite a logical process. After consideration, we found ourselves staring at an industry that's often untouched by small tech startups, the disability industry. Then, looking further, we realized that one group in particular seemed to be overlooked, the blind, visually impaired, and deafblind community. Now, disability is an umbrella term. It's a health problem, but it's also a complex phenomenon. A person may have an impairment such as blindness, but you are in fact disabled by the environment. A simple example would be, if you are blind and you go to a restaurant over the weekend, you are hand reading. Now you can read, sure, but you can braille. And because we live in a paperless world, there may be one print. This is just one small example of how the world works against you when you have a disability, rather than for you. We live in a time where a waitress will bring you a high chair for your child to sit in, but you can't expect the same for a braille and fast. Accessibility means access. It means that people with disabilities can live inclusive in society. It means that everyone has an equal chance to perceive, to understand, to engage, and to participate in their physical and digital world around them. Now, in a world where people with disabilities of a greater minority group. Why does society keep turning a blind eye? I mean, yes, is it really worthwhile making everything accessible? Are there enough people to merit it? The answer is yes. According to the World Health Organization, there are 1 billion people who have a disability on our planet. That's 1 in every 7 people. And to put it into perspective, this auditorium today seats 450 people. And if our environment allowed for it, there will be 64 people here with a disability. They will actually fill up the first 3 rows of 300 people. And in the game, society seems to look the other way. Another shocking fact is the fact that people with disabilities are less likely to not be employed. Out of the 258 million visually impaired people on the planet, less than 1% have a job. After speaking with a friend of mine, Chris Fenter, who's also known as the Blind Speaker Gap, he said something that struck me. He said, there's a difference between being unemployed and unemployable, and that people with disabilities are not unemployable. They may have the necessary skills and knowledge to be able to do a job successfully, but they need the right tools and environment to do so. And in today's world, their companies can put so much effort into making sure that they have a diverse workforce. For some reason, they turn and look the other way when it comes to employing people with disabilities. But come on, isn't it difficult? Isn't it difficult to employ someone with a disability? No, not at all. So to turn reasonable accommodations in the workplace, and basically it means modifying a job, the workplace, or how things are done in actual work, so that people with disabilities have equal opportunities to employment. And here's a few examples that you and the companies you work for can do. You can change the hours of a job for someone like better and technology to work. You can raise or lower a desk for equipment for someone in a wheelchair. You can install screen magnifiers or how about telecommunication software for someone who is deaf? Now these may aren't eye-boggling, jaw-dropping, difficult solutions that you and the companies you work for can do. Now I have to admit, I'm quite a tech class. I'm always excited when new technology comes out to help people with disabilities. And yet the trend continues to be in hardware, and hardware is expensive. And unfortunately, at the end of the day, this expensive hardware is actually inaccessible to the people who need it. I think it's time I take you back to our entrepreneurship class. what Chuck and my mind built, or what he built, and what we've been working on every day since. We found ourselves exploring a world of digital accessibility. We learned how blind people use their smartphone, how they do everyday tasks, and the struggles that they face. We created a platform that connects blind, visually impaired, and deaf-blind people to sighted volunteers like yourself all around the world. An example would be, if I wanted to pick up my pizza, I could take a picture of a pizza using my pizza in the app. It would then be sent to a community of sighted people, who would then reply back and say, you can eat up the pizza for 8 minutes at 180 degrees centigrade. Enjoy. It's that easy. Now, we know that you, as a sighted person, have a very busy life. Your days are full of back-to-back meetings, you're taxiing your children around, and you're just trying to catch a break. So the traditional forms of volunteering just